sunny summer Sunday on a clifftop by the sea. I'd made myself a picnic lunch, some sandwiches and tea. I'd been there half an hour when I heard a sort of moan, and gradually it came to me that I was not alone. He was hanging by his fingers from the edge of the abyss. He'd been there quite some time. Now let me tell you this, when it comes to clifftop picnics, I find it pays to be particular. Always choose the horizontal part. Altogether, never the perpendicular. I could see he'd lost his tablecloth, his condiments as well. His teapot too was missing. He was upset, I could tell. There was no long preamble, no extended peroration. He limited himself to help by way of conversation. It's a very English thing, but as he hung above the sea by his fingertips, I asked him, "Would you like a cup of tea?" I poured the man a cup, and he was so elated, he took it from me straight away. Perhaps he should have waited. He clung on by his left hand, in his right his cup of tea. His options were quite limited. His fate was up to me. In view of his position, my next move was not a smart one. I said to him, "Do you take milk?" and handed him the can. I was afraid that he had gone to certain death so far beneath, but as he passed an overhanging branch, he clung onto it with his teeth. In his left hand, still the milk. In his right hand, still the cup. I leaned over the cliff top. I looked down. He looked up. When they asked, "Was it my fault?" I must confess a great unease. I called down, "Do you take sugar?" He looked up and said, "Yes, please." Franco, Prussian War of the Spanish Succession. A bunch of soldier boys had been on a long hike and found themselves in Macclesfield. The next day being Sunday, they went into a church. One of the Franco-Prussians saw one of the soldier boys take out a deck of cards and said, "Soldier, put away those cards." He was Swedish. The next day the soldier was taken before the provost marshal. The marshal spoke to the Franco-Prussian saying, "Frank, why have you brought this man before me?" "For playing cards in church, sir." "What have you to say for yourself, son?" "Much, sir," said the soldier. "I hope so, for if not, I shall punish you more than any man was ever punished." The soldier replied, "Well, sir, when I see the ace, I think of what they call frozen water in Harrogate." Has everybody got that one? "And when I see the two, I think of the two stomachs of half a cow. When I see the three, I think of the number of horsemen of the apocalypse when pestilence is having a day off to run in the 245 at Ascot. When I look at the four, I think of the number of legs on part of a centipede." You're not taking me seriously, are you? "When I see the five, I think of the number of trotters on a pig and the spare one we've got in the fridge. When I look at the six, I think of the number of votes Norway have got in the entire history of the Eurovision Song Contest. When I look at the seven, I think of the Ten Commandments. When I see the eight, I think of the number of trotters on a pig because I just ate them. And when I think of the nine, I think of the number of trotters there would be on three horses if they're all pigs and had a leg missing. When I look at the ten, I think of the number of lords a-leaping some bastard left on the doorstep after Christmas. When I see the jack, I think of the number of trotters on a pig if it's left overnight in a car park in Brixton. And when I see the Queen, I think, perhaps I'm in the wrong bus queue. When I see the King, I think, what's Elvis doing working in Tesco's? And when I see the four suits, it reminds me how many suits I'd have in the wardrobe if I had another four in a wardrobe. When I count up the number of cards, it comes to 52. The number of weeks in the first half of this year and the last half of last year. There are 12 picture cards. The number of eyebrows on 6 armadillos. And when I count up the spots, it comes to 365. And I'm reminded of a small bottle of Thousand Island dressing. So you see, my deck of cards serves me as both a bauble and an Armagnac. Folks, this story's true. I know. I read it in the Sun. Experienced deja vu for the first time. I reckon the first time deja vu happens is the second. Deja vu. A rhyme. It is impossible to experience deja vu for the first time. I reckon the first time deja vu happens is the second. I started with verse 2. Verse 1 must stay unlistened because the first time you say deja vu, it isn't. But then, to get a little more immersed, you can't experience deja vu twice because you didn't experience it first. To recap, deja vu. A rhyme. I know what you're thinking. This is not the first time. Three times and still it isn't true. How do you qualify? What do you have to do? How do you climb this mountain? Or you may think it's just a hillock. You may think this man is a philosopher. Altogether, you may think this man is a hillock. I've been called a pillock before. Strange but true, when I hear the word pillock, to me it is deja vu. A rhyme. It is impossible to experience deja vu for the first time. I reckon the first time deja vu happens is the second. Then again, this is interesting. There are those who say deja vu is a once-in-a-lifetime thing. Then they say it again. And at the risk of being a bore, if you go back to the first time deja vu happened, you'll think, that's happened before. We should explore the supernatural. Put knowledge in place of mere feeling. Edinburgh University has a chair for the paranormal. They can't get it down off the ceiling. Too many gaps in our understanding. Is time travel a thing of the past? What was the best thing before sliced bread? How long does this poem last? Are Blackpool hallucinations real? But to return, as to an old friend, deja vu. Yeah. Lost amongst the wildebeest and the springbok, chasing the seasonal rains. There once lived a family of zebras, a small group of sisters and brothers. And there was one who stood out from his fellows. spot was not like the others. Somehow he stood out in long grass, where others somehow seemed to blend. When you're trying to hide from the lions, a zebra calls Spot's not your friend. Nature can play cruel tricks. You might see it as victimization when the rest of your family are barcodes and you're just wild punctuation. Life can be hard when you're different. Sad how cruel folk can be. Strange how the world can be hurtful to someone not like you or me. Spot may have been modest and clever, the fastest, the kindest, the best. But Spot was soon banished forever, for Spot was not like the rest. I went to his brothers and sisters and asked how all this came about. The trouble is, he's really a leopard. And we don't want to be there when he finds out. So he stands all alone in the grassland. Life's furrow alone he must plough. For Spot was not like the others. Spot was different somehow. Sometimes hear a deep rumble, a voice underground that says, hey. The old ones understand. They hear the earth speak and they know that sometimes the earth says, I. And sometimes the earth says, oh. A Pacific volcano erupts, lava flows red to the seas, and rock and ash and earth fly through the air with the greatest of ease. It's the bowels of the earth. In places they spread far and wide, Maui, Hawaii, Oahu. They've come to the surface and dried. In terms of prolonged drought, the length of a word may grow shorter. When it hasn't rained in Yorkshire for 6 weeks, there's no effing water. Two T's, an L, an N, and an S were years ago wasted away. The lost consonants of Atlantis. Or A-A-A, as we know it today. The earth is a teacher. We may listen and learn if we choose. The very first sound in the world was the sound of primordial. The earth teaches as well. Another new concept is born as from the four corners of the globe comes the idea that a globe has corners. I've been to the ends of the earth. I've gone where the wise never go. I've peered through the A's at the sea. Or as the French know it, oh, blessed are the peacemakers. And much as I'd like to say yes, I've got nowhere to put it, so I cannot accept your largesse. I'm a beekeeper. Begone, OS, you are unbecoming. Oh yes, I'm the great bee tender. It can't be a bee, it's not humming. Are these vowels, you might ask? These are not. Is what I will tell. And should you reply, oh, IDR, I will tell you, RDL. The fowls of the earth lie beneath us. If you listen, you'll hear them below. The land that belonged to some farmer. E-I-E-I.